السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، as we were listening to the recitation tonight, some of the ayat we talked about the subject of building the masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in this surah two kinds of masjid being built, and two categories of masjid. Masjidun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it masjidun dirar. A masjid that is dirar, and the word dirar means like saying evil, meaning evil plotting and conspiracy and so on. ومسجد الله سبحانه وتعالى قال أسس على التقوى من أول يوم. That was established on taqwa and righteousness. Means that the basis and the foundation of this masjid were fearing Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And Allah عز وجل says there cannot be equal at all. The first one was Masjid Dura. Means the purpose of building that masjid was just to create furqa, means a division and creating fitna in the Muslim community. And the story of that masjid, as you know, from the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Rasulullah azza wa jal built the masjid, that was ussis ala taqwa, that was established on righteousness and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means sincerely for the worship of Allah azza wa jal. The hypocrites, the munafiqeen in the community, they found themselves alienated, meaning, you know what, if we're going to keep going over there, they feel that they're under pressure to behave and act and interact in a certain way. So what is the best way to do? Let's isolate ourselves. And they built their own masjid, and they wanted to establish their own practice, basically get lazy, you know, mocking the deen and so forth. Rasulullah ﷺ was notified about this in the Quran, and Allah Azza wa Jalla gave him the command to take that masjid out. The masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, should solely be based on that principle of purity and sincerity to Allah Azza wa Jalla. There should be no masjid that is called Masjid al-Arab, Masjid al-Pakistanis, and Masjid this and Masjid that. There's no such thing. There is no such thing as masjid based on a specific ethnic line or ideology and so on. It's supposed to be all for Allah and for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why they are called Buyutullah, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's see this house that Allah described in the Quran as Ussisa ala taqwa, that was established on righteousness. Now, of course, the tafsir, some of the ulama, they say this is the Masjid Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and others, they say it's actually the Masjid Quba, the first masjid ever was built in Madinat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And both of them were established on the foundation of taqwa and righteousness and fear of Allah azza wa jal. As-Sahaba radiallahu anhum, in the house of Rasulullah, in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now look at the simplicity of the structure. The simplicity of the structure, which means the masjid, it's about the essence. And that's the inner structure, not the outside structure. The outside structure is only the shell. Doesn't necessarily mean that the masjid from inside is great. So it's just like building a house, but there is no home in it. You don't feel home, even though that you built this amazing mansion, but you can't feel that it's home. Why? Because the inner structure is completely destroyed. So the house, the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was built of palm tree pillars. These were the pillars of the masjid. And then the walls were made of adobe and rocks. And then the roof, there wasn't even a roof to say actually that there was a roof. Instead, it was only just the palm tree leaves covering the front section of the masjid. And when you say palm tree leaves, what are they going to be covering anyway? If it rains, is that going to stop the rain from coming down on the floor? Of course not. How was it furnished? It was furnished with pebbles and gravel. Now we live in Texas, mashallah, and you know the heat. Alhamdulillah, there's a temperature these days in the lower 90s. Now for some people this is too hot. For us, alhamdulillah, this season, mashallah, we're happy. It's not 102, 103, 105. It's not in the hundreds. It's not three digits, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. But imagine at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when again there was no shade to protect the floor and the gravel from catching the heat. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they used to use their forehead, they used to use their imamah, their turbans, in order to place that on the ground to protect their forehead from the heat. They used to use their sleeves to put their hands, their palms, inside their sleeves and put them on the floor so that it doesn't get scorched by the heat of the pebbles and the gravel. SubhanAllah. Can you imagine that? And we live, mashallah, in the beauty of these musallat and masajid covered Yes, it gets a little bit hot because even air conditioning with mashallah full masjid like this, it keeps blowing and blowing and blowing and says, that's it, I can't give any more. And some people complain, ya jama'ah, turn the fans on, others say turn it off, and we start complaining. But the house of the masjid of Rasulullah ﷺ, they didn't have the luxury that we have today. Still, as you can see, the outer shell of the masjid of Rasulullah ﷺ was extremely, extremely simple. Today, you don't even call that a masjid anymore. But back then, it built a home for the whole Muslim ummah and community. And that masjid, Rasulullah, or for that masjid in particular, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called that it's a house of Allah Azza wa Jalla, إِنَّمْ يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُسِّسَ عَلَى التَّقْوَى, the foundation of such a simple structure was based on fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ غَدَى إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ أَوْرَاحِ أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُزُلًا كُلَّمَا غَدَى أَوْرَاحِ. Whoever makes a journey to this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the masjid, Allah Azza wa Jal will prepare for him, Allah will prepare for him nuzulan, which means in Al-Jannah, a place in Al-Jannah, every time he goes to the masjid and going back home from the masjid. So when you go to the masjid, again, regardless of the structure, you get that reward from Allah Azza wa Jal. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِنْ بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِنْ بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ. When a group of people, they gather in one of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ, reading the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ فِي مَا بَيْنَهُمْ, and they study the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down إِلَّا غَشْيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ فَنَزَّلَتْ عَلَيْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَ السَّكِينَةِ وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. That Allah Azza wa Jal will send down to them the angels to surround them, and they will feel peace and tranquility surrounding them as the presence of the angels brings peace and tranquility for them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be remembering them, will be mentioning them by name in front of other and better congregation, and that's the congregation of the Malaika. Imagine Allah Azza wa Jalla in a gathering like this right now, know each and every one of us by name. For us, it's something we can't even comprehend, but for Allah Azza wa Jalla, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whose knowledge is beyond our imagination as human beings. So you cannot really comprehend that, because again, we have a finite and limited capacity of understanding. But Allah Azza wa Jal is the greatest, is the all-knowing, al-alim, al-hakim, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was housing some of the greatest people we've ever heard in the history of Islam, jama'ah. People like Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, Umar al-Khattab, Uthman, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abu Huraira, all these righteous people, subhanallah. It was their almost like their house. Abu Huraira in particular, he was the leader of Ahlul Sufra. The back section of the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to house the poor people of Medina. They were poor. They didn't have shelters like we have today. They didn't have houses, they didn't have hotels or motels, and they didn't have that. They had the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, being the poor of the poor, the poorest of the poor radiallahu anhu, he was the leader of the Muhajirin. Those who come from outside the city, they have nowhere to go, they have nothing even to start their life off with, so they spend their days and their nights in the masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the back of the masjid. But of those Ahlul Sufa, they became the Qurra, those who memorized the Quran, those who learned daily on daily basis from the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ulama, scholars, came from that section, that very simple place and very place in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu wa sallam. The masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again was the house of the people, so that whenever someone wants to relax and they want to get out of the house, where do they go? To the house of Allah azza wa jalla. And they would act like they're at home, meaning they take their naps, they sleep sometimes in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They become sometimes very casual in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because it became like their home for them. How many occasions, how many hadith we've heard when a man came looking for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Sahaba will be pointing to Rasulullah, saying, you see that man over there who's lying on his back? Lying on his back, meaning he's just relaxing in the masjid. He says, that's your man. Subhanallah, very casual. And sometimes if you see that man sitting in the middle in front of it with his friends over there, with the people over there, that's your man, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's being there on a regular basis, salawatullah wa sallam. One day, علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنه, he had some issue with his wife Fatima, the daughter of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. You know, when a man and a wife, they fight for whatever reason, يعني. What is the natural reaction of a man after he had an issue with his wife? What does he usually do? I wish the sister can give an answer. They will tell us what men usually do. If a man and wife they start basically talking, the man gets upset, what is he normally does? Leaves the house. He normally leaves the house. Basically, he cannot take the argument of his wife. He gets so stressed out from the discussion, he leaves the house. One day, Rasulullah went to the house of Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, and he asked about Ali. He says, where's your cousin? She goes somewhere. He went out. So what happened? She basically told the Prophet we had an argument, and he just left. So the Prophet ﷺ, he went looking for Ali ibn Abi Talib. Where was Ali radiallahu anha? He was sleeping in the masjid. Poor guy. He was sleeping in the masjid, and the turab, he made basically a pile of dirt. Again, the masjid is furnished with pebbles and dirt. So he made a pile of dirt and he was sleeping on it, radiallahu anhu. And the dirt was kind of hanging on his face, on his side. So the Prophet he saw him and he just bent down, he just kind of started pulling him up. Again, that's his cousin. The boy he raised in his house, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's also his son-in-law. So he bent down for him and he pulled him up and he goes, Qum Aba Turab. He called him Abu Turab. Turab means dirt in the Arabic language. Because the turab was covering him, so he would start kind of brushing the dirt off his side, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, Qum Aba Turab, just Qum Aba Turab. So he pulled him up and he took him to the house of Fatima and he reconciled between him and his wife, radiallahu ta'ala anha. The point that we're making over here, that the masjid has actually more than just the role of making salah jama'ah. The masjid is your home, wallahi. This is when you need to find your comfort. And I'm sure that we all have so many distractions in our houses. Many distractions. But when you come to the masjid, distractions all of a sudden they've dropped almost to zero. You have only one focus, and that's to make your ibadah, to just charge your spiritual battery, connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and feel the moment, and then go back home, hopefully inshallah ta'ala, with better attitude towards your family, your children, and those who are around you. So this is inshallah the beginning for all of us. And I would like to remind you that inshallah ta'ala, on August 2nd, we have our fundraising to establish our masjid, bi'idhnillah, our full-time masjid, let's say, that is inshallah they're gonna be yani, the masjid of the Valley Ranch Muslim community. I want you to mark your calendar, March 2nd, to come and join us, bi'idhnillah, azza wa jal.
August 2nd.
August 2nd is Imam. March 2nd is going to be that's the next year. But now it's August 2nd, inshallah. Friday, August 2nd, we want you, bi'idhnillah, to come and bring your family and share with us the opportunity of building this another opportunity for the Muslim community, inshallah, ta'ala, to enjoy these beautiful environments and atmospheres of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So may Allah azza wa jal make us among those who build the house of Allah azza wa jal. That is based on righteousness and taqwa. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.